Good afternoon. Welcome to fifth session of IPC Master Class Biosafety and 10th session of IPC Master Class itself. I think the whole world is desperately looking for some vaccine, and we all are looking for a person by Dr. R. Subramania on vaccinology. I will be interested to mention her. Before starting the session formally, as we do, a quick view on the video of the our sponsor Cyanide. So just hold on for a few seconds. So we are very thankful to Cyanide Healthcare and Ramdas. I request Ramdas to at this concluding session of IPC Masterclass Biosafety to talk to the all participants.
Thank you, Pranav, and a very warm welcome to all the participants in the panel for this concluding session of the second webinar series on biosafety. It's been a pleasure hosting IPC Masterclass for the last 10 sessions, the first being on epidemiology, where we had the topic of outbreaks, epidemics and pandemics, holistic understanding, and then the second one at biosafety. All the sessions have been very fruitful, and the feedback has been very encouraging. Very happy to know that we have as many as 1,300 odd people, the healthcare professionals who have registered with IPC Masterclass. And the feedback is really very encouraging. And, this particular initiative has been possible, and it's not a SANMED Healthcare alone, but it's a group of, teams who have worked towards it. And I think a special thanks to Dr. Rangareddy for, giving this idea, and also the fact that helping us to collaborate with University of Hyderabad and PHFI, IIPH, and along with, of course, IFCAI, where Dr. Ranga is the president with the Infection Control Academy of India. It is a difficult time, and for the speakers to take time out of their busy schedule and making this particular series possible, I really salute them. I really thank them, commend them for the hard work they are doing. And especially in biosafety, I think I want to thank all the speakers. We had the first session with Dr. Aruna Pujari, Dr. Mustafa, Dr. Savitar, Dr. Saurabh Maiti, and of course, today we have the last session Dr. Sukanya is going to take. And thanks to Dr. Sukanya for being there for the first webinar series and this one also. I think a special thank to two of the doctors who really contributed, who were really advisor for this a particular series was Dr. Ranganathan Iyer and Dr. T.V. Rao. I think they gave a lot of ideas, and they said that why don't you do this? Why don't you make corrections? And I think it helped immensely for making this particular webinar series quite successful. I think coming to the objective of the webinar series, we always looked at helping the healthcare professionals to gain more knowledge from the more knowledgeable ones. And that's where the speakers who have the knowledge, they disseminate the knowledge, and I'm sure it has benefited a lot of them. And we said that the second objective is to also create a knowledge bank, right? I think when I say knowledge bank, we are talking about the YouTube channel, because every session which we have, right, that's an addition to the, that's an deposit to the knowledge bank. And our YouTube channel will have all the webinars which has gone through all these, all the 10 webinars and the coming webinars. So just imagine the kind of knowledge which is there in that particular channel. So I would suggest all those participants to really go through that, and also inform those who could not actually attend to visit that and keep subscribing that, because anytime a new webinar is done, they will be informed accordingly. And it's very easy to remember. It's youtube.com/SandMedHealthcare. I think that if you go to that particular channel, you will get all the sessions which we have had so far. Coming to SandMed Healthcare, all of you know, and you've seen the video, I think we are one of the largest manufacturers of products for IPC. And we have the entire armamentarium when it comes to the IPC product lines, actually. And we have one of the best manufacturing facility, the WHO GMP certified manufacturing facility. Quality is our core value. And that's where I think we are different than many other companies who are there in the market. Right? We will continue with this webinar series, and we need ideas from you, because these are some of the ideas which the two series we had came up with some of the doctors whom we interacted. And you are all there. You know what is best required for, you know, this particular space of infection prevention and control. We have got few ideas which I have tried to put it up, and I would like all of you to go through that and suggest which one would be making more sense, because we want to get into the third series of webinar. Right. So maybe we'll give a couple of weeks gap, and then we would look at getting into the next webinar series. So you have the poll, and I would like to you to please look at what would be a better subject, you know, for us to take the third webinar series. So Pranav, I think the poll is already on, I think.
Yeah, people have already.
Yeah, so we have the occupational safety for healthcare workers in pandemics as the first top subject given, vaccines for healthcare workers, food safety in hospitals and healthcare, hospital support system is the next one. And of course, biomedical waste management in COVID pandemic, housekeeping practices, administrative controls. So these are some of the topics. And good, I see. The first topic, which is occupational safety for healthcare worker pandemics, taking the maximum need as per the participants we have here.
So you have any other topics also, you can put it.
Yeah, in. So that's a thing I was about to say, that these are few of them which has come from some of the doctors. And I think I need to mention some of them being Dr. Dhruv, who has helped us in giving us some ideas. Dr. Saurabh Mathi gave us a few of the ideas. And you know, a couple of other doctors have helped. So I think these are a few. I want you to put into the chat box if you have any exciting ideas which you feel could be. So I see Hima Mol saying biomedical waste management is really need of the hour. And if anything else which is not given in this particular, you know, list, I would be very happy, you know, that if that can be taken up, right? So maybe we have this session today. You have my email IDs, and you know, please communicate through email. Send us email, and then we will definitely discuss with the, you know, core committee, and then we will see and we'll shortly inform you what will be the third webinar series we are going to start with, right? So a very heartfelt gratitude to each one of you, and especially all those speakers who have taken time out and really done a wonderful job. And I think we are committed to this particular initiative of IPC Masterclass. We'll continue this, and I'm sure over a period of time many of the healthcare professionals will be benefiting out of it, right? I think thank you so much, and I think I don't want to take more time, and hand it over to Pranav to carry forward this particular last session, concluding session of the biosafety webinar series. All the best, Dr. Sukanya. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ramdas. Thank you for your support to IPC Masterclass. Now, to start the session, immediately, I request Dr. Ranga, President of Infection Control Academy of India, to start the session, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Again, a very warm welcome to you to the last session of IPC Masterclass Biosafety Series. During the last 4 weeks, we have been getting a lot of feedback on the quality of the material. Synchrony with the kind of idea what we had, the synchronization with the kind of objectives we have set forward for this particular series. The kind of feedback what we have received is quite overwhelming, and definitely it is quite encouraging to think of more new initiatives which are going to make IPC as a team which is going to really help all of us as healthcare professionals and also our patients to live in a very safe kind of environment. Now coming back to the biosafety series, for those of you which are attending for the first time, we have actually given to all of you earlier that the main objective of this session is to ensure that the enough of knowledge is given so that we can lower the risk of exposure at all stages in the healthcare system. That is what has been kept as a main objective, and all the four sessions which have happened prior to today have really been synchronized in such a way that you get the maximum benefit out of this series. So I am sure post this session we will have a higher confidence in order to deal with bio risk within our institutions, to take care of actually the biosafety at a next level. Today, Dr. Sukanya is going to talk about mostly the vaccinology, which is a hot topic. I am sure it is going to be really opening our eyes in terms of actually what is vaccinology, how do we go about it, how does it have a kind of interrelation with the biosafety, and how does actually it going to help in order to deal with the pandemics and also to deal with the IPC, because these are all interconnected areas, and I'm sure she will be able to throw a lot of light on that. And just before actually handing over the mic to Dr. Sukanya, a few words, I would like to talk about Infection Control Academy of India, because a lot of people had been from all over the world, not only from India. I think in India, most of the people are already aware of the initiative Infection Control Academy of India, which has got a single line objective to create the bandwidth of infection preventionists in India, to create the cadres who are going to take care of not only the mundane, the work related to infection prevention and control, but also prepare the cadres for the kind of pandemics and endemics what we are seeing today, right? That has been the larger objective of Infection Control Academy. And, the most people from Cambodia, Myanmar, Kenya, Saudi Arabia, you know, all these countries, they had been asking, how is that we can actually have some kind of, you know, interrelation with Infection Control Academy of India. I would like to say, Infection Control Academy, although it has been started by few enthusiasts, where today more than 1,200 members are there, it is all yours. You know, all of us are the stakeholders. All of us are part of the Infection Control Academy of India. In whatever way you want to actually work with the Infection Control Academy of India, you are most welcome. You can contribute by way of actually writing articles, by way of writing, you know, white papers, by, you know, doing some research where, you know, Infection Control Academy also can become part of it. You can be an author of some of the manuals we prepare. You can be an author of some of the, you know, chapters which we actually give it to as self-learning material for our students in PG diploma course, which Dr. Sukanya also has contributed a few chapters in the PG diploma program. Like that, you know, the opportunities are varied, and you can choose how do you want to contribute and how do you want to also, you know, collaborate with the Infection Control Academy. One other way is, you know, you can also actually suggest the topics for the next sessions, where you can also, you know, become a faculty. That is also, you know, one opportunity which you can look at. So the opportunities are immense. We are all together in this initiative. It is not that, you know, we have got a somebody, you know, who is sitting at the helm of it, and rest all are, you know, just somebody, you know, like a viewers of it, right? No, you know, here everybody is an owner of this particular process, and in whatever way you want to contribute, you are most welcome. And you know, end of the session, you would also have a link where you can actually fill in the details and become a member of Infection Control Academy. And it is free of cost as of now. And most of our activities are run through philanthropy, you know, through various contributions which are coming from individuals, you know, who are concerned about public health, and those organizations who are concerned about public health and who are providing through their corporate social responsibility some kind of funding and also help to take up the various activities in the sphere of public health, especially infection prevention and control. One of such organizations is SanMed Healthcare, you know, who had been providing us with, you know, both the technology and also, you know, other support, monetary support, in order to conduct these kind of programs. And there are multiple other organizations, you know, who had been supporting our initiatives. And I go on record thanking all of them for their support, both monetary and non-monetary support. And I'm sure, you know, in the years to come, their contribution and their support is going to be crucial in order to reach the target of Infection Control Academy, to train at least 50,000 healthcare workers in India and probably more in other countries. So with that, probably I'll stop in regard to Infection Control Academy of India. And now I would like to request Dr. Sukanya to take over. She doesn't need much of intro. You already know her. You know, she is a frequent speaker in all the IFCAI forums, and including all the sessions which we have been conducting. She is one of the best consultant microbiologists I know, and very enthusiastic infection preventionist. And she constantly upgrades and also shares the knowledge, you know, which she acquires. That is one of the best things, you know, what can happen to all of us. Learning is one thing, but sharing is another thing. By sharing, I think, you know, we are only going to fortify our knowledge. Thank you, Dr. Sukanya, for your contribution.
And thank you, sir. Good afternoon to all of y'all. And thanks, a special thank you to, you know, IFCAI and SanMed for giving me again an opportunity to interact with all of y'all. especially as a, you know, a very difficult and a different topic, I would put it. I would not say it's a difficult topic. It's actually a very challenging and interesting topic, biosafety and vaccinology, right? And it actually made me read a lot about manufacture of vaccines, what are the biosafety, you know, precautions associated with it. So without much ado, because I think we're already lagging behind in time, so we'll go directly to the slides, right? So when we talk about, so when we talk about vaccines and biosafety, there are two important topics by themselves, right? Biosafety has already been covered to a large extent, both in depth and width, okay, by very good speakers, you know, in the past so many weeks or few days. And vaccinology as such is again very important to us. All of us, you know, we'll be thinking about, okay, vaccinology has been selected this time because everybody is waiting for a COVID vaccine, right? It may be partially true, but the important thing is that vaccines have a very long history. And they have in fact been, you know, regarded as the greatest public health achievement, okay, of the century, in fact, by CDC. And the crowning glories of actual vaccinology are the eradication of smallpox and the Rinderpest. Okay, right. Now, when we talk about the history of vaccines, we date back from certain practices by the Chinese called variolation, wherein, you know, the Chinese physicians used to actually inject the dried scabs of smallpox into non-infected patient, people during epidemic time, so as to prevent the transmission or to prevent more people from getting infected. Okay, so starting right from there, okay, we have progressed from the 16th century onwards to 17th century, 18th century, where in 1796, where Edward Jenner actually pioneered or developed the first vaccine, which was the cowpox vaccine. And then we had another century later, we had, of course, Louis Pasteur, who actually developed the rabies vaccine, of course, which had its own side effects. Then from there, we went on to more purification, refinement of the vaccine manufacturing, methods. And we went on to killed vaccines. Okay, with the advent of cell lines, we went on to actually inactivated live vaccines, inactivated and attenuated vaccines, as well as killed vaccines. They started using toxins, okay, chemical inactivation of toxins and converted into toxoids, which we commonly used in DPT, right? Then we had subunit vaccines, conjugate vaccines, we have combination vaccines, and now with the advent of the 20th century, right, there was a lot of focus and development in genetic engineering, okay, which was one of the tools of molecular biology. And we again had very important, interesting vaccines, like which were developed from recombinant DNA technology. Examples: the hepatitis B vaccine. Then we had therapeutic vaccines. Some were used for cancers. Okay, so, and if you actually look and if you look through the literature on vaccines, it's amazing from where to where we are now. And I firmly believe that we require more and more younger people to actually get into the pathogenesis of infections, so that they can identify which are the important proteins, what is the actual pathogenesis mechanisms, what are the pathways of pathogenicity and virulence, and go into more of research, so that we can actually develop better vaccines for the future generations, right? Okay, now why are we talking about biosafety, right? So whenever there is a vaccine manufacturing unit, okay, there are certain inherent risks in handling these pathogens, because there can be uncontrolled release, okay, and that can lead to exposure to the lab workers as well as to the community at large, especially if they are aerosol-borne infectious agents. Okay, therefore, whenever you talk about a vaccinology or the manufacture and production of vaccines, right, or the methods of vaccine production, we have to take into consideration three important factors. One is the risk assessment. Second is biosafety perspectives. And the third most important is the biosecurity perspective. Now, all these three go hand in hand and have to be considered in the same order. First, do a risk assessment, then look at the biosafety, and then the biosecurity. Now, when we talk about risk assessment, the important points which we need to keep in mind are the risk group of agents. So, what is the agent? What is the hazard we are dealing with? Okay, what type of an agent is it? And we need to classify the agent as per its risk, Then environmental factors. If you're working in a laboratory, what are the engineering controls? What are the equipment controls, right? All those things. Then high risk activities. We have to identify which are the high risk procedures which we are going to do in a lab, which are likely to result in an exposure. And last but not the least is the healthcare status. Okay, or the health status of the laboratory staff. That means the lab workers who are working, not only the workers who are actually working on the bench, the people who are in working in that particular vaccine unit, okay, all of them are regarded as personnel, the, okay, lab personnel. And therefore, they could have varying immune responses, right? They could be immunocompromised. There could be some pregnant staff. Okay, there could be certain people who are non-responders to vaccines themselves. Okay, so all these have to be kept in mind whenever you are doing any risk assessment for a particular unit, right? So as I told you, we have the risk group of the organism, other risk assessments of the organisms. That means rather than first assessing, first we need to assess as to what class of agent does it belong to, risk group or risk class. Then we need to also understand what are the different routes of transmission of the agent, right? As we have already covered in the previous topics, you would have covered these things. And then what are the risks from lab procedures? So based on these three fundamental data which we get, okay, on the organism, on the procedures, on the modes of transmission, there are four biosafety levels which we can come to a conclusion. We can say that this particular activity or this particular unit requires a biosafety 2 or 3 or 2 enhanced, etc. Okay. The important thing is the backbone of practice of biosafety is actually risk assessment. And therefore, I am going to dwell a little bit more in detail on how to actually do a risk assessment of your lab. If you have not yet done, even if you're not a vaccine manufacturing unit, if you're working in a small clinical laboratory also, even small microbiology clinical laboratory, please do a risk assessment. Because there are certain small procedures and activities which we may not even think about, you know, on a second chance. We may not even give it a second thought, but they could be potentially dangerous and they could expose to accidental infections to your personnel. So the backbone of biosafety is risk assessment, and most important, other than these all other things which I'm going to talk to you about, you have to use your own professional judgment when we are going to delineate or build or define what biosafety level we really require. Yeah, now these are some factors considered for a risk assessment. For example, natural route of infection, the pathogenicity of the agent, okay, the concentration and the volumes of the infectious agent which we are going to deal with, okay, what are the known routes of infection and what are atypical or alternate routes of infection which we may not commonly see or even would have read about. We need to investigate a little bit more on that. Okay, then what is the outcome? Suppose a lab worker exposure, life threatening, is it mild, moderate, right? Then availability, if there has been an exposure, what is the availability or of both prophylaxis as well as therapeutic interventions? Okay, right? Again, when you're talking about disinfection of laboratory, of the surfaces, of equipment, you need to understand what is the stability of the agent which you're dealing with in your environment. Okay, right? Also, risk reports from previous studies of infectious agent or toxin. This is very important when you are going to say that I am dealing with a biosafety level 2 or a 3. We need to understand what are the agents we are dealing with. And little more research has to be spent on whether these agents can behave atypically in a laboratory environment when we are going to do a genetic manipulation or genetic combination, right? So you need to do a little more in-depth research into the agent, okay? The potential consequences of malicious use are extremely important, and this plays a major role when you're going to consider the biosecurity aspects, which I'll come to you later in the presentation. Okay. Also, the level of genetic manipulation, which is intended for production of a vaccine. Okay. So these are some of the important. The last, which is marked, is actually my laboratory does not perform a risk assessment. This is risk. Okay, so please do a proper risk assessment and then understand what is the biosafety level which your lab is at. Okay, and then we can go on to how we can actually ensure biosafety for our workers. So the first poll question is, what are the main factors when you do a risk assessment? Yes, is it A, hazardous agent, exposure, vulnerability of staff? B, you can see, I think, the poll question.
Yeah, it is on.
So,
yeah, we are getting response.
Wonderful.
So the people who are new, you can see just below the slides, these questions options are there. You can simply touch and respond the options.
Yeah.
So next 10 seconds, we are ending the poll. Okay. It looks that majority of the people responded to option one option. So here is the result. You can see 78% responded to hazardous agent exposure vulnerability of staff.
That's absolutely right. I think all the previous speakers need get the credit of, you know, in emphasizing this point. So wonderful. That's absolutely right. Okay. Yeah. So when we talk about when you do a risk assessment, the major three factors are the hazard, the exposure and the vulnerability. These are the three things which we need to keep in mind. Okay. The routes of exposure can vary from inhalation to ingestion. Okay. And the risk assessment actually sets up a framework for constructing a comprehensive biosafety and a biosecurity architecture. This is very important. Okay. There are four phases in a risk assessment. One is hazard identification, hazard characterization, okay, exposure assessment and risk characterization. That means how risky have the laboratory, have your personnel been exposed to? What is the level of risk your laboratory personnel have been exposed to? So these are very important parameters when we talk about risk assessment. Yes. So again, the first thing which I told you is the hazard or the infectious agent, which we need to classify. Okay. So we know all this class 1, 2, 3, and 4 are the different risk classification of infectious agents. And the other consideration of the organism or the agent which you need to include, okay, would be the ability to produce toxins, concentration, volume, okay, the invasiveness of the pathogen, okay, then whether it's a genetically modified or a multi-drug resistant organism, okay, whether it is resistant to commonly used disinfectants which are used for disinfection in the laboratory, okay, right? So these are some of the important things which you need to keep in mind along with the risk classification of the infectious agent. And also we have to look into whether it is a zoonotic disease and whether there are any known, you know, recommended prophylaxis or therapeutic guidelines for the particular agent which we are dealing with. Right. Now, when we talked about the exposure, so we finished about the hazard, right? Now we're talking about the exposure. So exposure directly relates to activities in a laboratory, right? So activities in a laboratory could be any of these. It could be centrifugation, vortexing, spinning, opening a vacutainer, opening a sample, okay, right? Processing of samples, okay, discard of biomedical waste. So many activities happens in a lab, okay? So from make a list of all the micro processes which happen in your laboratory and look at what are the potential hazards which are associated with each of these activities, right? So basically you can look at exposure to biohazardous agents, okay, material through inhalation, okay, if there is going to be a risk of transmission of infections through inhalation, okay, then exposure to blood-borne pathogens, spills and splashes, okay, and inoculations with syringes and hypodermic needles. Okay, so you need to understand, will the procedure produce aerosols? Will any hypodermic needles and shafts be used? Will animals be infected? Am I going to conduct an animal experiment, especially when you're talking about vaccines? Okay, and also will there be any new procedures or equipment which will come into my lab for a particular production of a particular vaccine or for a particular work which I need to do, right? So all these need to be kept in mind when you're going to define what is the exposure level. That means what is the high risk activities which is going to happen in your particular lab. So this is a strategy for risk assessment. Okay, this is a beautiful table, right? It basically it's a planning for risk assessment. Okay, you will identify the hazards, you will look at what are the work practices hazards. Okay, you will identify what is the specific task I'm going to do. Okay, you will look at engineering controls, administrative controls. What are administrative controls? Administrative controls is, for example, the security, whether personal, there is a restricted access to the facility. Yes, then you will also look at whether what type of PPE I should be wearing or the people who are working in that particular lab should be wearing. Okay, and do also an assessment of the likelihood of exposure, right? What is the consequence of such an exposure if it happens, and what is the established risk? So we know, for example, if you're dealing with HIV, right? Bloodborne pathogens. We know there are specific defined percentages for transmission of HIV through sharps, right? Through needle pricks, through splashes, they are defined. So what is the established risk percentage if there is a likelihood of an exposure? Okay, so then you have to put a control plan. What are additional controls, any process improvements which I need to take, you know, which I need to implement in my laboratory, okay, so that I can reduce the level of risk to the minimum. Okay, and other than the existing controls which I already do have, what are the additional controls which I require, okay, essentially, okay, and when will it be achieved? So this is a strategy for risk assessment of your laboratory. Okay, there will definitely be a laboratory safety officer in every laboratory, and therefore this is an imperative responsibility of the laboratory safety officer, right? Also, we need to annually review the risk assessment, monitor whether what we've assessed is actually correct. We need to add in more points. Okay, a new procedure has come into the lab. How do we identify and do a risk assessment for those? So those things will come under the review of the risk assessment plan, which should be done on an annual basis. Yes. Now we come to the next part. That is, we have already done a risk assessment in a particular laboratory, which is basically anything, which can be a clinical microbiology laboratory. It could be a molecular biology laboratory. It could be a vaccine production unit. Yes, we have finished about risk assessment. Now we come to the other two important topics, which is the biosafety and biosecurity. Now, if you look at the definition of biosafety, I'm not going to repeat it. It's from all the webinars, I think it's already been told and drilled, okay, and explained very well. Okay, so basically it describes containment principles, right? Level 1, level 2, level 3. It describes technologies and it also describes practices. So these three are the major components when you talk about biosafety. And these three, how these are going to be implemented so as to prevent unintentional exposure to either pathogens or toxins or their accidental release. So this encompasses the whole concept of biosafety, right? Now, what is biosecurity? Security refers to institutional security measures. So you're working in a laboratory, you're dealing with certain agents which could be used for bioterrorism, which I think Dr. Savita had already spoken about very in depth and beautifully. Okay, so what are the institutional security measures and what are the personal security measures which are designed to prevent the loss, theft, misuse, diversion or intentional release of pathogens and toxins? So these both terms are extremely important for us. It's important for you to differentiate biosafety and biosecurity. Okay. Right. So when is it relevant to consider issues of biosafety? Right. I understand when you're working in a routine clinical small microbiology lab also, it is imperative to consider biosafety. Okay. But when does it become extremely important is when you're dealing with vaccine production. Okay. In combination with GMP, which means good manufacturing process. Okay. GMOs, when you're dealing with genetically modified organisms. Okay. And of course, when you're talking about research, diagnostic and control laboratories, biodefense, these are some of the areas wherein biosafety plays a very, very important role, right? Now, when you talk about a program of biosafety, we first, as we already have discussed, is the risk assessment. Then accidental spill control, reporting of spills has to be emphasized. Okay, this is a common problem issue universally across all laboratories, because many of the laboratory workers do not report accidental splashes, accidental spills, because they're scared. Okay, so this has to be encouraged, okay, so that reporting becomes imperative, and you can actually encourage them and say that if you actually report, we are there to help you out if anything happens in the future. Okay, the next is decontamination and disinfection, again very important. Okay, as we are talking on a platform of SANMED sponsored event, I would like to stress this particular point that decontamination and disinfection is just basically most of the time left to the housekeeping staff. Okay, but this should not be the issue. Okay, you have to look at, as I already told you, whether the infectious agents which you're dealing with can actually be disinfected and decontaminated with the disinfectants which you're using. Sometimes it may not. You may be using something totally different and the infectious agent may be totally different. So you have to have a thorough knowledge of what are the disinfection and decontamination practices which is happening in the laboratory. Waste management, okay, animal handling and safety, especially specifically applicable when you're talking about vaccine production when you're going to deal with animal testing models. Okay, personal protective equipment repeated often in all IPC webinars, seminars, classes. Okay, but the most important part about personal protective equipment is the doffing, the donning of PPE, as well as what is the appropriate PPE I should wear for specific procedures or activities in the lab. So this is a very important point. When we talk about PPE, everybody says there's nothing to talk much about it because you just wear gloves, gowns. No, there is a process of putting on, donning, there's a process of taking off. Okay, and another very important thing is the type of PPE which you need to wear. Okay, so these are something, this is something which you need to keep in mind when you talk about personal protective equipment. Also, look at the medical, do a medical check of the your lab staff. Okay, you have to keep a record of their immunization status, their vaccines which are due. Okay, this is extremely important from occupational safety, as I've seen many of y'all were interested in occupational safety as a next webinar presentation. So this is extremely important. You have to have a biosafety committee and a biosafety officer. Packaging and transport, which Dr. Saurav has again very well elucidated in his presentation, is extremely important. And training. I will again emphasize, extremely important, because we feel once a person comes to the lab, he's trained at induction, then you know he gets onto the job and then he learns on the job. That's how it is in many places. But please, training is an ongoing, continuous, dynamic process, and you need to update your juniors and your seniors on the newer technologies, newer personal protective equipment, newer hazards which have been identified while working in the laboratory. Okay, so this is something which is very important. And the last, of course, is biosecurity. Okay, so I will not go through this in detail because we've already done it. The principles of biosafety are basically substitution. That means if you're doing something which is hazardous, replace it with a more safer procedure or a more safer method. Okay, technical safety. So when you talk about technical safety, use of biosafety cabinets, unidirectional airflow, the engineering controls like use of HEPAs or containment levels. Okay, and then organizational measures such as well written, clear, simple SOPs which everybody can follow. Okay, practices and procedures which you need to train on. Okay, and access control, very important, especially if you're working with a BSL, in a BSL3 lab, then you need to make people understand that you just cannot walk into a lab. Okay, so there should be a access control. And production flow consideration is very important when we talk about vaccines. Okay, so when you're talking about a production of a vaccine or in a particular laboratory, how various elements are processed, including the working seeds of the vaccine, the culture media, chemicals, animals, the wastes from the infected animals, okay, laundry, okay, and all the other considerations. The flow of events, the flow of procedures in a lab has to be very well written down and trained. People should be trained on the flow every time you talk about biosafety, right? Now, the essential building principles of biosafety, basically you have primary, secondary, and tertiary containment barriers. The primary containment barriers are actually what you wear. That is your PPE, right? That is the first barrier between the agent and the personnel. Okay, of course, other than that, you have biosafety cabinets, which are again, which will again come as a primary containment barrier. The secondary barriers are usually the airtight rooms, air handling units, the filtration capacity, whether you have a HEPA, airlocks, showers, and all, which will come in your BSL3 and BSL4 level laboratories, which has also been well told by Dr. Mustafa. I think he had talked about the different biosafety levels of laboratories, what are the essential features of each one of them very well. So all that will come as secondary containment barriers. Also, your laundry, your effluent treatment, sewage treatment, waste disposal practices, your disinfection and sterilization, all this will come as secondary containment barriers. The tertiary containment barriers actually represents an additional organizational barrier. Okay, that is basically like more of biosecurity. So you have walls, fences, zoning of your different areas like clean, contaminated areas. Okay, and then quarantine and animal exclusion zones, especially when you're talking about vaccine production units which have got animal testing. Okay, now when we talk about biosafety practice in the facility, especially with regard to vaccine production, there are two important things. One is called good manufacturing practices. Means, what does good manufacturing practices actually mean? It means how good your vaccine is, how safe your vaccine is. So GMP basically is concentrating on the product which you're producing in the laboratory, which is vaccine, right? Okay, it basically is that's the major thing. It protects the product or the vaccine, that it ensures that the product is safe and effective for the end user. Okay, that is good manufacturing practice. And what is biosafety? Biosafety basically actually requires more of protection to the laboratory staff as well as to the environment. So if you look at both these principles, sometimes you may think they may clash, okay, because in GMP you're talking mainly about protection of the vaccine and the product, whereas in biosafety you're mainly talking about protection of the staff as well as the environment. So how does this match? We'll come to that. Okay, so these are the synergies. So there are certain synergies. Okay, both biosafety and good manufacturing practices require restricted access. They require segregation. They require easy cleaning designs. Okay, minimization of contamination, validation of process systems, facilities, job certification, because you cannot put a person who doesn't know about his job, especially when you're going to talk about vaccine production on a large scale. Okay, mandatory training, personal protective equipment, okay, written policies and SOPs and documentation. Okay, these are all practices and principles which are synergistic between good manufacturing processes and biosafety, right? So what are the clashes? Where does it clash? I told you, GMP basically means keep out, protect the product. Okay, the product is the blue, right? So keep out, so protect the product, minimize the cross contamination. Okay, and production flow should be from dirty to clean. That means from raw materials of the vaccine, like eggs, the embryonated eggs, if you take that down to the purified antigen. Okay, so that is working from dirty to clean. Whereas biosafety looks at keeping in, that means protecting the employees, preventing escape of infectious agents, and workflow is from clean to dirty, that means from non-infectious to infectious. So you see, there is some sort of clash, but actually there are a lot of synergies also. Okay, so when you talk about vaccine production unit, it's important that both these aspects are kept in mind, and the practices and procedures and your SOPs and training are aligned to meet both these requirements. Yes. Okay. Now coming to the recommended biosafety level for infectious agents, I think I am not going to go through this slide because of lack of time, and also because I think it's been covered in depth, right? Okay, we'll go on to the poll question. So which biosafety level do you think is required for vaccine production? Yes?
Yeah, poll is on. We are getting response.
Good.
A, BSL 4, 19% people responded.
So
a majority, 55% people responded. BSL 3, BSL 4.
3 and 4.
Yeah, 3 and
so
4.
So do you really think you require BSL 4 for vaccine production? Okay, let's see. Yeah. Do you really require that? No. Okay. You really don't require a maximum containment level of biosafety for vaccine production. So there is another question anyway. When do you really require a maximum containment level? When you do not know about much about the infectious agent, when you have received something, you don't know what you're dealing with, you don't know the routes of transmission, right? And of course, there are defined specific agents which come under BSL-4. Okay, but for vaccine production, generally BSL-2 and BSL-3 facilities are sufficient. Yes. Okay. Now, when we come, let me come to vaccinology, because you'll be thinking, ma'am is only talking about biosafety, you know, nothing much about vaccines except some little bit of history, right? Of course, these, following slides are going to be a little more in depth, but I'm not going to talk about in depth because it's a lot of it is technical. These slides will be available to you. You can actually go through it for your academic purposes. But vaccinology, when you talk about it, basically includes basic science. Like you need to know a little bit of what exactly is the biochemistry, the protein, right? The immunogens, what are the immunogens of the particular infectious agent, Okay, what is the host immune response? So immunology to some level. Okay, you have to, it also includes strategies and technologies, delivery strategies. Okay, whether I can deliver it through an injection mode, it should be applied as a patch, I should give it as a tablet or a oral polio. Okay, so the delivery strategies and technologies, manufacturing. Okay, a large amount is manufacturing, and the most important is the clinical evaluation. All these come under the science of vaccines. Okay, now this is the crux of vaccinology. It has been expanded, okay, to further include safety, safety of vaccines, regulatory aspects, ethical aspects, okay, and economic consideration. You cannot develop a hi-fi vaccine spending crores of and millions of rupees and finally, you know, it's not available to the common man. It should be, it should, you should take into consideration the economic considerations, right? Now, the various methods which are already there in the production of vaccines, you already know, I think all of us will be thorough with this, are live attenuated vaccines. We started the science of vaccines development started with live attenuated vaccines. Then they moved to killed inactivated vaccines. Then the later important genetically engineered vaccines were the DNA and RNA recombinant technologies, reverse genetics, synthetic peptides, okay, which could be manufactured even without without the person actually growing the virus or, you know, or culturing the organism, okay, vectored vaccines and virus-like particles. These are some of the important different types of vaccines which we actually have presently. Okay, these are the classical methods of vaccines. Similarly, these are just some examples. So you have the pathogen, which can be a virus, a bacteria, a toxoid, whatever it is, okay, which is the, or even the clinical isolate, you culture it, you can inactivate it, okay, and produce vaccine. You can you do a antigen purification, as in the case of your acellular pertussis. Okay, you can attenuate the vaccine. Attenuation means retaining the immunogenicity but getting rid of the pathogenicity. That means attenuation. So you attenuate a clinical isolate and culture it and produce vaccines, or you can go on to the recent technologies of cloning and using genetically modified organism from the parent or the seed virus or the seed pathogen. Okay, so these are some of the methods of vaccine development, and this is again a very nice slide which actually demonstrate how egg vaccines are produced. Okay, so these are some of the methods. Okay, of specifically this is the egg vaccines are there for influenza, seasonal flu. Okay, you have preparation of vaccine viruses. Okay, you, so you have basically you prepare a vaccine virus. You take, you mix the seasonal virus with the laboratory virus, create a hybrid. Okay, these hybrids are again selected, the progeny or the replicons of this virus are selected so that are selected such, only those hybrids are selected which have got the inner components of the lab strain and the outer components of the what you want, but not exactly you want, okay, or the outer components of the target virus. This hybrid is then injected into 8 to 12 or 9 to 12 day old fertilized eggs, okay, incubated for a period of time, okay, for 2 to 3 days, and we can harvest millions of these vaccine viruses from the egg white of the embryonated egg. Okay, these viruses are then again purified, the antigens are extracted and then prepared as vaccines. So this is some a snapshot of egg vaccines. Then we also have cell culture vaccines. So rather than culturing them on in embryonated eggs, with the development of cell lines, okay, the viral agents were harvested and cultivated on cell lines. Okay, and again we had viral Hello.
Yes, I think we are audible.
Sorry, I think something happened in between.
Yes. I think you can again start. I'm just putting up your slides.
Yeah, you can go ahead. Now it's fine.
It's fine. Okay, yeah. One second. Just put the slides. Mr. Pranav, could you go put on the slides? Okay.
Okay. Just a minute.
I'm starting. Yeah.
Slide
yeah I think it's
oh my god, we have to go
oh my Sorry for that interruption.
No, that was a technical thing actually.
Okay. I think, yep. Yeah. Oh my God, quite a lot of slides, yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
So we were at cell culture vaccines. So similarly, as we had done with the, as you know, it's been produced in embryonated eggs, it is again, we can also produce them in cell lines. So this is an easy question. Which of the following are attenuated vaccines? Just to keep your interest alive during this session, I think all of you will be able to answer this. There is a little twist to this. I'll explain to it about it, this later to you. Wonderful.
Yeah, I think 100% yeah. People responded.
Responded to OPV, BCG, so and yellow fever. Yes, of course. So when we talk about live attenuated vaccines, classically we talk about OPV, BCG, and yellow fever. That's right. But attenuation can also happen through reassortment. Okay. So as in the case of influenza. Okay, I'll come to that later. But that is the correct answer. But influenza can also be regarded as an attenuated virus because it can be attenuated by passing through certain cell lines, and the virus can undergo some sort of a reassortment because it is a segmented virus. Okay. Now, the classical methods of viral vaccine development, I've already talked to you about this: attenuation and inactivation. Attenuation can be like, you know, chemical or physical oxygenation, or it can be passage. Okay. In embryonated egg, okay, which was the next one of the other methods. Okay. And after the development of cell cultures, attenuation in cell cultures became a very common thing for the production of vaccine. Okay. So this is another very important aspect of attenuation, which we need to actually keep in mind, because when we learned about vaccines immunology, we generally learned about chemical and physical attenuation methods and embryonated egg and cell lines. But cell lines, there are different ways of attenuating a particular virus, and these are some of the important ways in which viruses can be attenuated so as to produce potential vaccine viruses. Okay, so this, as I told you, that was what the question was, the poll question was. Okay, so attenuation is can be achieved by physical means, as in the case of rabies and anthrax, or passage in animals, okay, or in vitro, right? Or you can passage it in cell cultures, as in the case of this. And you also have passage in cell cultures can lead to reassortment of viruses when you actually passage two different viruses. Okay, one which is an attenuated virus and one which is the wild type virus. So you get a reassortment virus which you can actually use as a vaccine virus. Okay, so what is reassortment? Especially this is applicable for segmented viruses with got segmented genomes, which has influenza and rota. So reassortment, okay, can be used to combine genetic material which is coding for protective antigens of pathogens with genes coding for attenuated behavior in the host. So you can combine two viruses, one which is attenuated naturally in the human. For example, you can take an animal virus which is basically naturally attenuated and combine it with a wild type human virus, and the reassortment hybrids which you get, okay, will definitely have the ability to immunize without causing illness. And this is again a sort of a attenuation, but it is called as reassortment. Okay, and these reassortments have been fundamental preparation for the preparation of both killed and live influenza viruses also. Okay, so this is an example of the rotavirus reassortment virus, vaccine virus. Okay, I think you understood the principle. Okay, then the other is inactivated organism or subunit path. So this, I think all of you know it, you could use whole organisms, okay, which can be killed without losing immunogenicity. Now this is classically seen in typhoid, cholera, pertussis, influenza, and hepatitis A. And all of you I know would are looking at coronavirus vaccines, and we have news about Bharat Biotech in the media. So they are using this method of inactivation, whole organism inactivation, or killed inactivated viruses are the ones which are in trial with Bharat Biotech. Okay. Now the others is the exotoxins. So these toxins can be converted into toxoids. You can extract proteins of the specific virus, like you have hemagglutinin protein, uraminidase proteins. These proteins, purified proteins, can be used as subunit proteins, can be used as antigens to elicit an immune response. And you can also elicit the polysaccharides. Okay, the polysaccharides have been extremely useful, but important to note is polysaccharides are not as immunogenic as proteins. Therefore, when you're using polysaccharides as antigen, it is always important or imperative. It is actually always used in combination with a protein which acts as an adjuvant, as in the case of the Hib, the pneumococcus, and the meningococcal vaccines. Okay. Now, this is again a snapshot of the whole thing which I talked to you about. You can use killed whole organisms. This is where our coronavirus vaccine comes right now with Bharat Biotech. Then you have toxoids, you have extracts, okay? You have polysaccharides, and you also have proteins. And some of these proteins, peptides, have also been used as therapeutic vaccines, especially in the prevention of cancers. Okay, so the next poll question. Which of the following is not a new strategy for vaccine production? Which is not a new strategy for vaccine production? I think it's an easy one. It'll be done fast.
Yeah,
fine. Response, yeah. I think that's fine. This is an easy one. So we go to the next. Obviously, toxoids, right? Everything else is combined. It has gene genetic modifications. So obviously, it's very easy. Right. Now, what are the molecular biology strategies in vaccine production? Why are we dealing with the types and methods of vaccine production? Is so that we understand what are the precautions we require at when we are going to produce a vaccine using any of these methods. So we'll just go through these slides fast. Okay, the different molecular biology strategies. Okay, actually, knowledge of the base sequences of the genes of microbes has enabled us to look at various methods of vaccine production using genetic engineering. Okay, the most important thing which happened basically was the in 1990s was the whole genome sequencing. Okay, and Craig Venter was supposed to be the first person who published the genome of the first free living organism. Okay, so the whole pathogen genome sequencing was a major revolution which happened, which enabled us to identify genes. Okay, we could sequence the whole genome of the pathogen, and we could identify those genes which are of interest to us in terms for vaccine production. Basically, those genes which were immunogenic, which provided neutralizing, which could elicit a neutralizing antibody response, or which were involved in virulence, etc. So these were genes of interest, and these genes of interest were cloned. Okay, and these genes were then, after cloning, they were employed for recombination or recombinant DNA technology. So you could use these cloned specific genes of interest. You could insert them into some vectors. You could insert them into certain host cells. You could make it combine with another virus or another agent and have a reassortment happening. So all of these led to DNA vaccines, subunit vaccines, and vector vaccines. Okay, so these are very important because this is how vaccine technology is going to go forward from now onwards. Yes, so with the newer strategies for vaccine development, starting right from the DNA, complementary DNA, as well as RNA of any of the viruses or the agents, have led to different strategies, like you have live recombinants, okay, protein production, recombinant protein production, replication defective particles, which are also called as virus-like particles. These particles will only have the proteins, but they will be empty. They will not have a nucleus, or they will not have nuclear material. Okay, so these can elicit also a very good immunogenic response. Okay, you have alpha virus replicons, naked plasmids, reverse genetics, which is now the upcoming technology. Okay, and specific we also have strategies like use of specific peptides, okay, for as therapeutic vaccines for cancer, and also specific T cell receptor proteins which we can target for certain diseases, as in the case of multiple sclerosis, so that we can actually control or regulate the immune response. Okay, now when we talked about recombinant DNA technology, it's very important that any vaccine laboratory who is actually involved in production of vaccines using rDNA, that is recombinant DNA, have to follow the requirements of the DBT, that is Department of Biotechnology guidelines, which is guidelines for research involving recombinant DNA molecules. Okay, these are some of the major important points which you need to keep in mind. I am not going to read the slide. It is for you to go through, and you can share or you can refer if your particular vaccine or anybody wants to really do a recombinant DNA technology for vaccines. Okay, this is again the biosafety aspects of rDNA technology. Okay, they have different categories of experiments using recombinant DNA, and which of the categories mandates an institutional biosafety committee approval, which does not. All these details are given in this specific slide. Okay, newer technologies other than genome sequencing and cDNA, DNA, RNA is microarray analysis. Okay, this is extremely important because we can actually define which are the virulence genes of the organism. We can look at how if an organism or a pathogen enters, how the virulence can actually, the response can be modified. Okay, that is another important thing which we can look at as both therapeutic options. In silico epitope analysis, that is when you're going to look at epitope analysis. Epitopes are specific, structural configurations of proteins on cells, okay, which may be specifically they are, we refer to them in when we talk about T cell epitopes, because they are very they are involved in antigen recognition and building up of immune response. So if you analyze these, the structure of the epitope on the T cell, we can actually make out as to what antibodies, what type of vaccine we need to create, okay. That is another thing. And proteomics, so proteomics is the field of protein analysis, which is parallel to genomics, like how you can do a whole genome sequencing and identify the whole gene and, you know, use it for vaccine production or genes of interest, cloning them. Similarly, you can actually analyze which are the proteins of a particular agent or infectious agent which are important in virulence, okay, in eliciting an immunogenic response, and that can actually help us to manufacture synthetic peptides, synthetic proteins. You don't even have to use the organism. You can do crystalline structure, and proteomics is one of the field wherein they have actually using 3D and bioinformatics and biotechnology, they have restructured synthetically proteins of importance and used them as immunogenic peptides. So this is another very good upcoming field. Okay, so this is how I have already talked to you about it. This is basically how reverse vaccinology can help us. Okay, so this is again reverse vaccinology. So basically, blood collected from a vaccinated or infected human. Okay, there's isolation and sorting of antigen specific B cells and plasma cells. Okay, generation of naturally derived antigen specific antibodies. So once an infected agent is injected, an infectious agent is there in a particular host. Okay, the blood will contain, obviously, there will be an immune response to that particular agent. Therefore, there will be B cell immune response, which are, and plasma cells which are producing antibodies to that particular infectious agent. These antibodies, okay, are studied. The genes of these antibodies are studied, okay, and you can actually look at how you can make a specific antibody response to this particular antigen. Okay, so using bioinformatics and structure based analysis of that particular antibody molecule, you can, using the antibody, you can derive the antigen. That is why it's called reverse vaccinology. Okay, you're getting the antibody, you're analyzing the antibody, and by analyzing the antibody, you're reverse analyzing, you're getting an indirect analysis of the protein or the antigen of interest. Okay, and these antigens can then be used. You're synthesizing these antigens as synthetic peptides or antigens outside the body and injecting them as vaccines. So this is called as reverse vaccinology, right? Okay, now poll question. Who is the final authority for approval and licensing of vaccines in India?
Yeah, we are getting response now, and response, oh, I thought it will be, it is mixed now. So we are ending the poll now. We see 68% people responded DCGI, while 14% DEAC and 12%, 14% DBT. So
yeah, so that is the correct answer. Okay, the answer is DCGI, okay, which is the Drugs Controller General of India. Okay, this body is the final approval and licensing authority in India. So this slide basically talks about how the approval and development path of a vaccine happens in India, what are the different governing bodies and authorities which we need to get clearance and approval of, especially if you're dealing with genetic modification, genetic engineering. Okay, so this is one of the important things. The most critical step whenever you talk about a vaccine production is the biosafety committee, institutional biosafety committee. Okay, you have a vaccine production unit, you have to have a biosafety committee. So that starts, the whole thing starts from the development or the making of a biosafety committee. Okay, now when you talk about hazard identification, now we've talked about biosafety aspects, we've talked about risk assessment, we've talked about how, what are the different vaccines we have, what are the methods of production. Now we have to combine all these, right? So what is the hazard identification in a vaccine manufacturing unit and what are the biosafety measures? Okay, so what are the first, when you talk about it, you have to look at what are the hazards which are associated with any pandemic virus vaccine manufacturing. Okay, so this is dependent upon the type of the pandemic virus, vaccine virus. Okay, whether it's a reassortant virus or we are going to use a wild type virus, right? So wild type viruses obviously will require a higher biosafety level, because why do we call viruses as wild type? First of all, because they are wild, because we do not have a proper they are not in the lab. Okay, they keep evolving in their own ecological natural cycles, and therefore the population may or may not have been immunized to those viruses. So that is why they're called as wild type viruses. Okay, these are the dangerous types. Okay, then it also depends upon the method of production, egg based or cell based. If you're going to use egg based, there is a higher risk of aerosol transmission of these viruses. Okay, or if also depends upon whether you're going to use recombinant virus vector technology or inactivation methods. Okay, also the hazard risk is dependent upon the deliberate modifications of the virus. Now suppose you're going to do recombinant technology or reassortment technology, so or you insert genes of one particular virus into the other, so you need to understand what is the homogeneity of the virus, whether there'll be shedding of this particular virus. Okay, and what is the potential for this vaccine virus to recombine with other wild type viruses? Because what happens, suppose you're dealing with a vaccine virus in the laboratory and you have a seasonal ongoing epidemic or a pandemic of a virus in the community, and the lab workers exposed to this recombinant virus, if he goes out, he gets a secondary infection with the wild virus, there can be a secondary reassortment in his system. And that is something which we need to be very, very careful about. So these are some of the hazards which are associated with the vaccine production, okay, of viruses. So hazards from production in eggs and cell lines basically requires a biosafety level 3. Okay, the most hazardous production whenever you're talking about production of vaccines from eggs is when there is a harvesting of eggs, that is the eggs have to be opened, as I already explained when we talked about how vaccines are produced from embryonated eggs. So when you're harvesting the viruses, okay, from the allantoic fluid of the egg, okay, there is a very high risk of inhalational exposure, okay, aerosols and spills which can happen, and it can be a major environmental hazard. Even disposal of all the eggs, the waste from all these embryonated eggs and all, has to be done in a very, very careful manner, and this requires a biosafety level 3. Okay, production as cell lines also definitely, specifically when you're talking about introduction of samples and removal of these samples into bioreactors or cell culture flasks, roller bottles, some of the viral cell lines require aeration. Okay, so that's why that is roller bottles. And also when you dispose liquid and solid cellular debris from the cell lines, these are activities which are extremely hazardous and require a biosafety level 3 precaution. Right. So what are the hazards from vaccine viruses? Okay, now when you talk about inactivation steps, when you say that I have produced a vaccine by inactivation, the steps should show complete viral inactivation. Okay, it's very important, because that's a very important thing. So how will you show complete inactivation? There are various methods. I'm not going to dwell into that because of the lack of time. But when you do an inactivation of anything, the steps or the processes should ensure, you should be 100% sure that the virus has been inactivated 100%. Okay, then of course the other important aspect is the biosafety risk associated with shedding or unintentional release into the environment following vaccination. Okay, so suppose subjects are participating in clinical trials. You have developed a vaccine, okay, and we are going to, obviously you will have a phase four where then there'll be a clinical trial, okay, human trial, and you will be actually vaccinating clinical subjects, okay, or trials. And when this happens, the people who have received such a vaccine definitely should be placed under appropriate clinical isolation, especially if it is in the interpandemic or a pandemic alert phase. If you are developing the vaccine in this phase, they should be placed under appropriate clinical isolation, because from these people who have received the vaccine virus, there can be unintentional release or shedding. Okay, and again, I already told you the vaccine virus is an experimental virus. Okay, if this is shed into the community and there is an ongoing seasonal wild type virus, there can be a reassortment, okay, which can happen, and that could lead to a total hybrid virus which can cause another wave of a different pandemic. Okay, so we need to be extremely careful. The other thing is reassortant viruses. Okay, now as such, I talked to you about reassortant viruses, that is like in the case of rotavirus and influenza viruses, attenuation through cell lines by combining a wild type virus and a attenuated virus. Okay, so you get a hybrid virus which is reassortant. Reassortment means it contains genes of both, okay, and which is favorable for vaccine because it is immunogenic but not pathogenic. Okay, such reassortant viruses are generally, by innately, they are not harmful. But suppose an infection happens of a laboratory worker with a reassortant virus, okay, and he simultaneously contracts an infection with a wild type virus, again, as I told you in the previous point, there can be a different type of reassortment and it could lead to a different pandemic. So these are some things which we need to keep in mind when we're talking about use of genetic recombinant technique or reassortment techniques, okay, when you're in the production of vaccines. Now, how do you prevent these hazards? You can vaccinate the workers and the clinical trial. Suppose you're taking clinical trial subjects, you're going to tell that I produced a vaccine by genetic modification, and I'm going to use it for a group of people, the clinical subjects. Then those subjects vaccinated against the seasonal flu or the wild type virus which is circulating in the community, so that when they go out in the community, they do not get the wild type virus infection. That is one. You should also vaccinate the laboratory workers who have been working on reassortment virus technology in the lab. So vaccination with the ongoing circulating wild type virus of both the clinical subjects as well as the lab workers will prevent this of secondary reassortment from happening. Okay, that is a very important point. Okay, now these are the different biosafety levels which are required, okay, especially when testing different candidate vaccine viruses. Okay, especially when you're talking about the pandemic influenza viruses, this is a very important thing. If you look at it, most of them are BSL-2 enhanced. They require BSL-2 enhanced contamination. And some of them, especially when you're talking about, if the candidate virus is a wild type virus, okay, then obviously it requires BSL-3 enhanced containment zone. Otherwise, most of the other strategies, if the other candidate viruses like reassortments, modified viruses, okay, anything else is used, you only require an enhanced BSL-2 level of containment. Okay, so here again, this is a very important flow chart from the WHO guidelines, which talks about what are the different containment precautions we should take, for what are the different biosafety levels which are required while for every step of vaccine production. Okay, so please go through it. I'm not going to go through it in detail. Yes. Okay. Now we talked about biosafety 2 and 3. I think already this has been covered. So I'm not really going into detail, but I think Dr. Mustafa has covered this. The important things about biosafety level 2 enhanced containment levels which are required for pandemic influenza vaccine facilities are only, in a nutshell, these important factors. The facility should be designed and operated according to the stages of manufacture of vaccine. Okay, so if you're, as per the process flow, the design of the facility has to be developed. Okay, then you have to protect the vaccine, that is the product, that is GMP, good manufacturing process, as well as the staff, which is a biosafety precaution, okay, as well as the environment and also the community. So all these factors have to be kept in your mind when you're talking about designing and putting protocols when you're talking about protection. Okay, controls in a BSL-2 enhanced facility which produces influenza vaccines are relative negative pressure biosafety cabinet, HEPA filtration, and positive pressure barriers or negative pressure inline sinks prior to exhausting, whether you are exhausting through the liquids, especially when you're harvesting viruses from eggs, embryonated eggs and all, you need to have this in place. Okay, decontamination of all waste from VSL to enhanced lab is a mandate, and also decontamination of all potentially infected areas at the end of a production of a vaccine. This decontamination has to be 100%, and there should be a validation of the decontamination, right? Okay, now BSL-3 again, design, I'm not going to talk about, it's already been covered. I will highlight as to what are the important points in a vaccine manufacturing unit which requires a BSL-3 precaution, okay? So this is required specifically when you're culturing and characterizing virus assaying vaccines, okay? And it is, okay, the important is when you're going to challenge the efficacy of a virus, okay, using laboratory animals. So when you're using when you're challenging the virus efficacy using the laboratory animals, and when you're culturing and characterizing the virus, the vaccine virus, then you require a biosafety level 3 containment. Okay, it should be designed to control aerosol transmissible pathogens. Okay, so obviously a double door entry, personal protective equipment, doffing, donning, a shower room, an anti-room showering, airlock, all these are very important parameters. Okay, unidirectional inward flowing air exhausted through HEPA. All work should be performed within a negative pressure and HEPA filtered biosafety cabinet. Okay, and the facilities must contain an autoclave for sterilizing infectious waste. So it should be within the laboratory premises. Okay, even a BSL-3 containment area. Also, there should be an institutional biosafety committee when you're talking about a BSL-3 facility for vaccine production. And this will conduct risk assessments for research involving engineered genetic material so as to ensure that an appropriate risk mitigation plan is in place. So this is a very important aspect of a BSL-3 facility for vaccine production. Additional regulatory constraints could be there, okay, depending upon the coronavirus species. Okay, for example, the previous 2012 corona, SARS corona, has been tightly regulated as a select agent. Okay, so similarly, obviously, the SARS-CoV-2, which we are dealing with, also will be characterized under this. Okay, so this is a very important document, which I would recommend that all read through it, because it gives a very detailed plan of what are the risk assessment guidelines for production of especially influenza pandemic vaccines. Okay, now the other important thing when we talked about personal protection, when you're talking about laboratory workers working in labs which are manufacturing vaccines on a large scale, the important thing is that the PPE should be very specific. Okay, so they should wear full body protective Tyvek suits with N95 mask. Okay, very important. Then there should not be any contact of these lab workers with susceptible animals like farm animals. Okay, pigs, horses, hens. Okay, why? At least for 14 days after departure from the vaccine production facility. This I have actually, it's important because there could be secondary reassortment. That means you could get an influenza virus from any of these farm animals any of the farm animals influenza virus could infect the laboratory worker who would already be maybe probably exposed to the vaccine virus, and there could be a secondary reassortment. So this is one of the important precautions which we should ensure, that none of the lab workers who have worked with these vaccine viruses, okay, should be in contact with any of the farm animals for at least 14 days after departure from the vaccine production facility. That's a very important thing. An extension of this too will be for another 14 days if the lab worker actually develops influenza-like symptoms, obviously from the vaccine virus, okay? The other important thing is immunoprophylaxis and antiviral therapy in cases of accidental exposure should be kept in mind. Prophylactic vaccination with inactivated influenza vaccines, I've already told you, it is important to vaccinate the lab workers with the wild-type community strain, okay? And decontamination, we talked about validation of decontamination. Just want to emphasize on validation. Validation basically means that you have to look at what are the types of disinfectants I'm using, what are the protocols, how frequently I should clean, what is the contact period, what is the dilution time, dilution of the disinfectants I should use, whether the disinfectant I'm using is actually active against this particular virus. Okay, so all these will come under validation of decontamination. Okay, so it's important to remember that while working in a high-tech vaccine production manufacturing unit, or you're working in a genetic laboratory, molecular lab, okay, you feel that, oh, wow, everything is so nice, hi-fi. So all that glitters is not gold. Okay, what is known to us as laboratory acquired infections is only the tip of an iceberg. And there are a number of cases of laboratory acquired infections which go unreported, undetected, or misdiagnosed as something else. Okay, therefore, biosafety has to be a very important perspective when you're talking about vaccine production units. So, which lab acquired infection was reported in India? It's there in the literature. Okay, very, very famous thing. Okay, if you go through, you can get it. Please don't refer your phones for this, but still.
But the response is very surprisingly 20%, 60%, 20%.
Yeah, so should we wait?
Yeah.
Finished?
Yeah, we'll wait. We are finishing now. So
you finish it because, you know, time is
yes. So it is 40% is brucella and smallpox, 36%, 18% influenza.
Okay, it is actually buffalo pox. Okay, so this was the buffalo pox isolates, the laboratory acquired infections by buffalo pox. Okay, which was reported in India. Of course, there have been various other reports. Why I have put the slide is there are so many laboratory acquired infections when laboratory workers have been dealing with viruses, especially for vaccine assays, for virus vaccines. Okay, so you have smallpox, you know, a 23-year-old lab worker who died of smallpox. Okay, so the plague, right? And of course, SARS and of course, buffalo pox. So in India, the major important lab acquired infection resulted in an outbreak and the laboratory workers were the buffalo pox. Okay, right. So these are the top five pathogens which are known to cause laboratory infections. And look at the lowest risk. Okay, so very surprising, right? So it's important for you to understand which are the agents which can be very, very dangerous for laboratory workers. Obviously, the first is mycobacteria. Then you have rickettsial infections, all hepatitis. Okay, A, B, C. Okay, then salmonella, shigella, brucella, leptospira, and coccidioids. So all of these are extremely dangerous. They are regarded as the top five pathogens causing laboratory infections in workers. The lowest risk of course, is cholera, tetany, and HIV. HIV also has a very low risk of infection. As a lab-acquired infection, it has got very low risk. Those possessing special risks are the novel pandemic viruses and pathogens to which none of in the community have got antibodies, and of course genetically modified organisms which are used in vaccine technology. So these are some of the special risk agents which we should know of when we are working with. Okay, so occupational safety, as we've already you wanted a seminar or a webinar, but I'll just put it in a nutshell. Basically talks about major three major things. Okay, one is screening at employment. Okay, this is very important. Looking at sero reactivity, immunization history, and re-evaluation of the sero status while assigning a new biohazardous agent. This is very important because once we screen our lab workers, when they enter, we say, okay, they are fine, they are vaccinated, they are showing antibody titers, and we leave them and we assign them to a new vaccine project or to a project which involves a totally different novel agent. Then we need to again check whether their immune status is fine. Okay, or not. So that is another important re-evaluation which needs to be done. Then of course you have annual health checkups and immunizations which need to be done, and these records are very imperative when you're going for any occupational safety audit. Okay, so personal immunization record should have all of these: screening, okay, sero reactivity, immunization history, okay, re-evaluation, and annual health check and immunization. Then post exposure prophylaxis. Okay, basically what you need to do is periodic testing, especially of those lab workers with substantial risk. Okay, those who are working with viral isolation from egg harvesting units. Okay, those people should have a higher risk, and therefore you should do a more periodic testing. Okay, consent for testing, consent for vaccination and counseling is a mandate. Okay, and strategies for responding to biohazard exposures, a training has to be done, education has to be given, awareness has to be done, and you have to actually conduct drills and explain to them what we can do when there is a biohazard exposure, right? So all this comes under training and awareness and prophylaxis. Okay, also a very important aspect of lab acquired infections when we're dealing with new agents or vaccine viruses are modes of infection and clinical presentation many times are different from naturally acquired infections. See, lab acquired infections do not happen in a natural setting. It happens in a laboratory setting. Therefore, the modes of transmission of such a infection, of the agent, as well as the capability of producing typical lesions will be different. Okay, it may produce atypical clinical features, it may produce subclinical infections or latent infections, okay, or they may be actually acquired by different method. So these have to be kept in mind when you're talking. So any subtle infection, okay, alertness has to be there to your lab workers for any subtle infection or any atypical presentations. If they fall sick, immediate alert signal should go as to why, what has happened, what are the clinical symptoms. Okay, so that has to be there. And reporting to trivial exposures has to be encouraged. I'm again and again stressing this point. It has to be monitored and encouraged. And special precautions, including temporary reassignments. Okay, especially when you're talking about female personnel who are pregnant or contemplating pregnancy, you have to reassign them on temporary basis, other lesser biohazardous agents or procedures. Right. Now, when we talked about occupational safety, what are the vaccines which are mandated for laboratory workers? Okay, you have these important ones which we should definitely have. Most of us will already have it as a part of our childhood immunization protocol. Okay, but of course, those who are working with specific viruses like JE and specific smallpox, if a particular person is doing, there's a specific smallpox 88 which you need to be vaccinated against. Okay, you have Q fever. Okay, and these other exotic and rare agents which we need to get vaccinated while working in those specific settings, right? So which of the following are statutory bodies concerned with biosafety in bio research? This is another poll question.
Yes, we are getting response now, 50-50.
Okay, so we'll go to the slides. Okay, so it is RDAC, okay, Recombinant DNA Advisory Committee. This is one of the important statutory bodies when you're talking about vaccine production using genetic engineering. Okay. Right, so this is again the biosafety regulatory framework, which is Indian, okay, and it's important that you know about this. Okay, and coming to biosecurity, I have already covered biosafety. When you're talking about biosecurity, a program of biosecurity again involves risk assessment. It involves physical security like your walls, your fences, the zones, personal management, material control and accountability, information security, okay, transport, and transfer security, and managing the biosecurity program. I'm running through it. What are valuable biological material? If you talk about what is valuable, okay, what you're dealing in the lab, what is valuable? So these include vaccine strains, culture collections, dangerous and exotic pathogens, probiotics, okay, research strains and industrial strains. All these are considered as valuable biological materials which require a very important biosecurity program. The physical component of a biosecurity program includes graded protection. That means you give, okay, this is anybody can access or only few people can access. You give a graded protection, access control, intrusion detection, capability of responding to an intrusion, training on it, and testing of the measures which you have put in place. Personal management includes employee screening. That is okay, screening, that means you are going to understand that this particular employee is capable of fitting into this role and responsibility, right? Correlate to the access authorization, visitor control, and badges. All these form a part of the personal management under the biosecurity program. Okay, material control and accountability has to be an imperative or important part of it, because you need to identify what materials to control. You can't identify everything which comes in and goes out of the lab. Okay, you need to identify which pathogens and toxins are of concern to you, how the materials will be controlled, okay, who is accountable, where is it going to be applicable. Is it going to be applicable throughout the facility or only in the research laboratories or in the culture collection centers or during transportation? So all these features you need to define in your biosecurity program. Of course, this is the risk assessment, and this, I'm just going to run through this. This is basically related to risk assessment in a large scale production. Okay, what are the important things which you can do, right? And the conclusion of this is biosafety and security are essential practices for all biological facilities, more so for vaccine production. Okay, and vaccine production units have to have complementary GLP, that is good laboratory practices, and good manufacturing processes. Okay, there are synergies and conflicts between the two. Okay, but there should be a way we should find a way to resolve these and to enhance the synergies. Okay, training again has to be, is the most important factor. Training of managers, experts and personnel is the most vital aspect when we talk about biosafety and biosecurity. Fine. Thank you so much for your patient listening. I've overshooted my time, but I think we started a bit late, and there's been a lot of technology related things which I could really go get into the depth because of the lack of time, but the slides are available for you, and any questions you can always ask.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Sukanya. As usual, very interesting, very deep presentation, the deep dive into vaccinology. I think, the most important thing, I take away from this session is understanding vaccines from the technology perspective, so that, we also know how does it, work, what is the basis for making them, what is the process of making them, et cetera, et cetera. And most important thing is, how to take care of the healthcare personnel, right?
Yes.
With vaccines. Providing in right time, etc. I think that's what it is. Since we have shot up the time, I will quickly go into a few questions, which have come from the audience. The first question from Dr. Shilpa, she is talking about BCG and MMR, the so-called vaccines said to have a role in preventing COVID. What's your opinion on that?
I really don't have any opinion. I have, there have been various trials of vaccines. The major thing in COVID, as per whatever I have been reading, have been targeted around the immune response. Okay, now BCG invokes a very good T cell or cellular immune response. Okay, so probably it's effective in that aspect. MMR, truly speaking, I have no idea. Sorry, I'm not an expert in that field. But BCG, yes, BCG has been an experimental vaccine in many situations, primarily because it can elicit a very good T cell cellular immune response and evoke memory T cells, which will be very good for heterologous immunity, right, as well as innate immunity.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I also haven't come across any of those studies, which are related to MMR. The second question from Dr. Surya Satya, is there a role of vaccine for a patient who has already developed a disease?
A person who has already developed a particular disease would have natural antibodies, would also have natural primed T cell responses because of the exposure to the immune system. So a vaccine would really not be as effective or may not really contribute so much. But natural immunity for different agents differs. Okay, many times some of the infectious agents will not evoke a lifelong immunity, right? Whereas some of them do have a long-standing immunity. So it depends upon how the infectious agent, what is its interaction with the immune system. Some of them, always any infectious agent when it is in contact with the immune system evokes two types of responses. One is called the T cell and the B cell response. B cell response basically leads to production of antibodies, whereas T cell response basically relates to formation of memory T cells. So that is why whenever we talk about vaccines, for specific vaccines we have boosters, right? For example, if you talk about DPT, you have boosters which you give. So why are boosters required is because there will be a waning of the immune response. So when you give a booster dose of a particular vaccine, it evokes the memory T cell to respond. Okay, and it primes more of the T cell response. It enhances that more number of B cells are also exposed to the particular antigen. So a person who has already got a particular infection, a vaccine may not really help him. Again, depends upon the infectious agent or the disease.
Yeah, vaccines are basically a prevention. That is what has to be remembered. It's less of a therapeutic value, more of a preventive value. What vaccines are available to lab workers to deal with the dangerous pathogens? It is by Dr. Saurabh.
Okay, so dangerous pathogens, like if you're talking about viral hemorrhagic fevers and Marburg, Ebola, you know, those, there are specific vaccines which have, again, they're all in trial phase for these viral hemorrhagic fevers. But there are specific protocol when you need to administer these vaccines, because they have to be FDA approved. There should be some sort of licensing authority or an approval wherein these vaccines can be used for laboratory workers. Okay, so dangerous pathogens is a little bit of a gray area, because if vaccines were produced in good amount and they have been shown to be safe and effective, then it would be out in the market by now. But the important thing when you're dealing with the dangerous agents, I believe, is the biosafety precautions. If your engineering controls and your personal protective equipment and all that is 100% fine, then there may not be really a need for making that particular laboratory worker receiving a trial vaccine. But there are specific vaccines available when you're dealing with dangerous agents, but they are very selective. And they are still, we don't know much about the safety.
Thank you, Dr. Sukanya. I think there are some more questions. I think, you know, we will address them more offline, not to continue with this. I think, you know, this is the longest ever session we had.
Okay, sorry.
So almost like 1 hour, 40 minutes, you know, we have been going on. Of course, you know, it's really very interesting and, you know, very immersive. We did not even feel the time of 1 hour, 40 minutes, almost 2 hours.
I hope so. I don't know.
Thank you very much. Thank you guys from all over the world, you know, who have joined us today. It was wonderful to see you all. Hope to meet all of you again in another web session very, very soon. I think, you know, all of you have voted for some of the topics which are very important for our COVID times or the pandemic times. You know, one more thing is, you know, while we are dealing with the current pandemic in whatever way we cannot forget that there are some basics which we had to address, which are out of the purview of the COVID. So the further topics, you know, we would be taking so that we can get to the new normal post-COVID. That means we had to go back into our institutions. We had to restart our practices. We had to restart our healthcare institutions. That means, you know, again, we had to brush up some of our probably forgotten infection prevention and control skills. So we will be coming back very soon with a team which is going to address all those areas. Thank you very much. And especially those guys, you know, who are, I see that about 9 countries, all of them. Thank you guys. Thank you for your patience, and thank you in the early morning and late night, you know, joining us. We will keep you updated on further presentations and further sessions. Keep tuned, stay healthy, and stay safe. Thank you very much. Don't forget to take the quiz so that, you know, certificates can be issued. And don't forget actually to share with all your colleagues the YouTube lectures, you know, which are going to be posted there. For all the 10 sessions we had, all those videos would be available in that. And please ensure that you are going to review them and you are going to share with you. Have a safe time. See you soon then.